So, hello, welcome back. This is the second webinar from the Mentice company, and we are going to discuss the TACE procedures today. And as a hibernating doctor, we also have to train on this. My name is Lars Lonn from Copenhagen in Denmark, and together with me is Dominic Stippel.
Hi.
Hello. From the Mentice company. So, we had this period of being a hibernating doctors. We doesn't do elective cases for the moment. So, I'll move that one forward. Anyhow, I would like to state that my pilots have the same position as we have with the team members there. It could see a little bit of fun when you see just one passenger on a flight and they're being upgraded to first class. But if you're a little bit more serious, what happens when pilots don't get their flying hours? And what happens when we don't get our 4 hours? We actually have to train to be ready for the day to come when we really have to do a lot of different procedures. And in the TACE procedures, there are different challenges and different ways to skin the cat. You have multidisciplinary conference, where you discuss if you should do an earth ablation or an operation or even an embolization. And then when you decide on embolization, it's also about what kind of embolization material are we going to use. And in tumors and more, we are going for permanent embolization with drug-eluting beads or beads. It's technically challenging because it's a widely variated anatomy with high complex structure. What would you like to use is cone beam CT for this as well. And procedures may be needed to be repeated multiple times. There also the thing called EmboGuide or something like that, where you actually can do vascular tracing and follow the vessels towards the tumor. Today we're going to show you a live TACE case from our portfolio, where we have from the DICOM data transferred in a STL file tumor in the right lobe, and we have cut the our time for you to spend looking upon us what we're doing in order for making the discussion a little bit longer. So we actually punctured the right side already. We have put in a catheter in the vicinity to the mesenteric superior artery. The great thing with this module is actually you have a proctor inside where you actually can catheterize the SMA and the celiac trunk, and you actually see here with a green tick that you can manipulate the guide wire and select the catheter up to the aorta. Mm. That's what we've done. Can you say something more about that, Dominic?
Mm. That was developed with our clinical experts in this field. So it's mainly for trainees that want to work alone or don't have the availability of a proctor, of a senior physician next to them. They can really work independent and get the basics of the TACE procedure already alone before they enter the cath lab for the more detailed training then later on.
So it's interactive. Does it even suggest things for you to
yes.
do as well?
Yes, it's suggestions and tips and tricks.
So this 63-year-old man was considered for chemoembolization, and they had a 2.2 centimeters mass in the right liver lobe. And the CT, three-phase liver protocol, concluded a tumor with areas of hyper-enhancement, like an HCC. And the labs panels were roughly within the normal range. So, as we said, we punctured the right front, and we are right in here. And as you see, I have quite a big field in here, so I would like to use the radiation safety rules here, so I use the shutters. And then we just shoot the angle. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we are in the right position. I just make a little flush there. I'm not in the right position, so I have to see if I can get into either the trunk or the mesenteric artery. This is causing me from time to time some problems. While I would like to go a little bit like this to find a better solution to find my way in. And if you go too low, you will probably get into the renals there. You want to see the renals?
Of course.
Oh, it's not. Well, it was. You are there. So you're too low. You can actually pre-plan your procedure so you can see where you are. Already here you can see getting into some troubles.
Just like puff here to see where we are.
Okay. No, down further down. Here?
That's
here.
That looks good. SMA, or?
Yes, it's SMA, very close to the SMA. You might need the guide wire to get out there.
Mm. Yes, there you go.
Yeah. So we don't need to see the mesenteric artery, really, but we can perform a DSA there anyhow, just to see how the proctoring side works. Would you like, please? Yeah. This is a protocol of the SMA, and now you see that it has a tick box with what we have done. It's roughly that. For the CT, we could see that there were no liver arteries going for the mesenteric artery, so we go up to the iliac again. That's a little bit strange how it works. If you ask me why am I shuttling around like this, it's because the table is fixed. If the table is fixed, it gives you some cognitive function problems when you move the joysticks on the table. All right, can we see if we can find the celiac trunk? One feature for the beginner is also that you can actually even have a map like this. This map is quite nice. We have a lot of colors coming up here. We could go coming back to that later. See where we are.
Mm-hmm. You are.
That's a tricky one, yeah. We go into the AP position.
This opens another feature of that module where the trainees ask to identify the different arteries here. We can just do a couple of them. The first question here now is to identify the left hepatic artery. So we need to do a DSA first to get some image on. And now we can select the left hepatic artery. Did I give it a try if I can find that? I do it, I just click somewhere, let's see what the reaction is of the cellulite that we can figure, and that was wrong, that was the right one. So then it must be the other one. That was pure luck.
But no, it wasn't. You did the model, so you knew exactly where it is.
We have the common hepatic, for example. So let's do one now correct. Oh, again, that was the proper, so where's the common? Further back?
Yeah.
Perfect. So that's how we can go through all of the arteries that are concerning the liver, and by that learn to identify them. So we'll skip the rest here for time's sake.
I love that button, skip guessing.
Exactly.
That's much better.
Good.
So now you're there, and why not use that one? I think we should do a better angle.
Mm-hmm.
And again. We can also decide on how we should use this. Cutters, like this. And we shoot an angle again, so hold your breath. Mm-hmm. And then, quite distinct and clear, you can see something coming in.
You want to have that as an overlay?
I want one image back as an overlay, please.
Mm-hmm. See, go on the pedal.
That's okay. In this position, I would like to go with the prograde wire and catheter.
So, and do you choose 014 wires?
Always 014. Mm-hmm. It goes with the prograde system. Prograde comes with a microcatheter and microwire in your wall. You have different sizes here. I mean, you could go for 2.7, 2.9, or you. The smaller ones are for prostatic embolization, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Catheter and blood wire.
You know, all the when it comes to HCCs, they are arterial, almost all of them. So they actually are neutralized from the artery.
Mm-hmm.
The liver has its nutrition, 80% roughly from the portal vein and 20% from the arteries. But these kind of arteries, these kind of tumors are arterial.
Good. Is the overlay good enough, or should we do another one? Is it fine?
It's okay, because we are anyhow needs to shoot in your angle and come closer. See if we are still in position when we come in now. Doubt it.
You are still. That's the wire first.
Here it comes, hopefully.
That's quick.
Here, there are many ways you can, if you have very elongated iliac arteries, etc., you can also have a guiding catheter, 45 French, for instance, to room up close to the origin of the cerebral artery. And through that one, you can have your Schwann catheter or Michelson catheter or any kind of hook catheter. And after that, you have your micro. Now we would like to get closer into this one. Or maybe you do that.
Want to use a torque or?
Yep. And here you need to shape your guide, your micro guide wire.
So you're using shapeable micro wires.
Make a nice bend on that one.
I can do a try here.
Micro catheter is said to be straight here, but I would like to have it a little bit like this. Make it a little bit easier to go in. You withdraw the microcatheter a little bit and then rotate.
The typical situation?
Absolutely. It can be very challenging to go inside in these ones.
You can try. Also change the wire shape if we shape it further.
Yeah, I use the
014. Yeah. Go for the 60 long, the 60 long maybe. Sounds like a good shape to get around the curve. See?
In your dreams, Dominic.
In my dreams, yeah.
Yeah.
Look.
Yeah.
Sometimes the dreams
true
come through.
Dream. Yes.
I give it over to you. Yeah.
So, in this way, when we're getting closer into this one, a cone beam CT would be very nice to have in the future. Now, back again, we have some problems, might be nice up there. The thing is that patient is breathing mostly all the time, because the patients are usually awake. You can always collaborate with them and ask them to hold their breath in difficult situations. So why not try
and go for a smaller caliber syringe?
Yes, we do, and you can do it either by hand. You take the wave. And we should shoot in angle in due time.
Just a second. You can remove the overlay and you can inject. Is there any consideration regarding the pressure while injecting those small arteries? Anything to consider?
Absolutely. I mean, you can't. You have to do it by 1 to 3 milliliters. You have to test first how it looks like. Here, even a little bit spasmic, so I would like to go further back. So, in real life, the problem there that we are not stable in the
with the excess. What do we do in reality? We just try to gain access again.
Yeah.
Just need to redo it.
So this is another hibernating problem. More and more of them. So we take this one, that one away. Mm-hmm. And we go for this one. Mm-hmm.
So we don't lose too much of it.
Roughly the LIA position should make the trip.
There you go.
Yeah. Going back again.
Want to go back in AP?
Mm-hmm.
You can insert the guide. I will rotate back to AP.
That was quick, wasn't it?
Want to gain time back? I guess that's the advantage of the simulator. Yeah. We can try those things and try them all over again.
A little bit of a. As we see where we
take this one as normal.
Enough. Now we know the weights roughly. Yep.
Now I can test injection again to see where. Hold on.
Now we have to shoot a little bit of contrast in there to see where we are.
Mm-hmm. Just select the microcatheter again and you get an injection. You can take that one as an overlay.
Mm-hmm. Move back with the micro wire. Move up, move away. In this position, you would do a combing CT or you shoot a real angle here. Why not shoot a real angle?
Mm-hmm.
Do that and hold your breath. That's fine. So we embolize from here.
You saw that little side branch coming off. That's still okay to embolize from this position?
Yes, yeah. I would do that.
Mm-hmm. Now we need to make a selection on our embolization type on our embolic. So you said, I think, drug eluting beads, particles. The size, is there?
300 is nice. It's for that one.
And with a suspension of 25 milligram of the chemotherapeutic agent per milliliter, we select that.
And those are made in advance already from the beginning.
Yeah.
So you get them from the pharmacists. And again, you should be careful to see where you actually inject it. You have the. I would like to see the scene once more.
Go on the petal also. Yeah.
You have the side branch there. I mean, you're right. I mean, it's a quite big artery. To somewhere you don't see any vessels. So you should go a little bit further on. Change my mind when I see it.
Okay, that's good. And that's why we train.
Yeah. I will go a little bit further up. It might be that I need to fix it anyhow, but let's do it from there. And then I will shoot a small angle from there.
You need to change back to contrast agent now. Yes. Do a small one from here. We're in a small side branch that is also supplying.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe a little bit withdrawing the microcatheter to get the full tumor, or doing this and then the rest.
Yeah, or you try to go into that one to save the other one. Well, depends on how much you would like to embolize. But let's do embolize from this.
Yeah.
So we change to regulating.
Same settings.
And here you have to be very, very careful what you do there. You have contrast into it as well. In the beginning, you are very careful like this, and it can be go on for hours. So if you would like to be a little bit more careless, be that in the beginning, because you really need your patience in the end, because when you see in the end, you will get a backlash in contrast, retrograde with the temperature. So this can take some time.
Maybe just for the sake of the from a detective point, we can zoom in a little bit so people see a little bit better, even though you would not do that in reality. You can get a little bit higher magnification here to give us, we'll have the catheter.
And as you see, it would have been nice if maybe if we know for sure that some of these vessels might open up if we embolize only the one who is at 11 o'clock. So one would maybe say that we should have gone into that one in 11 and then embolize that first and then see if something opens up from the others.
What are typical embolic volumes that you inject for this size tumors?
It could be, no, I mean, you have to check that there are no venous outflow into the lungs or into the portal system or anywhere else. But I mean, not too small, 300, 500.
I think now we see the beginning of some stasis here.
They usually grade this as no stasis, 70 to 90% stasis, and then 100% stasis. Why shouldn't we call this 100% stasis, just for the sake of this?
We can also, I mean, we could show what the reflex looks like also, for people to know what what we don't want to see. This one.
That's beautiful with all your dots there. Red dots.
Was red now bad or good, Lars?
Very bad. But you could also maybe have green dots when it goes in the right direction.
Until now everything was green.
Yeah. All right. Should we check where we are? Remember to flash this sideline before you go back.
You can do that if you want to. Yeah, we do that. We flush with saline before we retract
too far. Well, now we retracted it. But
yeah.
And as you see, we are in a very unstable position in the mesenteric artery. Oh, in the electron.
We do a PSA to see if there's still blood coming into the tumor or supply.
Actually,
it looks very good, though.
Yeah. Very didactic.
Should we do another? Would you do another injection from the 5 French, 4 French catheter also to see if there's another supply to that tumor?
I would do that. Yes.
I mean, if you would have cone beam CT, or might have seen.
Yeah, I would,
those before.
Yeah, I would go a little bit backwards like this, and then have a 4 French. I mean, you could do it with a micro catheter as well. But you can't do the amount of contrast, then you need a high pressure contrast.
Any risk that the tumor could be supplied by the left hepatic artery also?
Not in this case. Not in this case. So let's shoot an angle from here, see how it looks like. We don't see anything here. Do we?
No.
Yes, that's roughly that.
Very good. Then I think we're ready for our questions sections.
Thank you.
Let's bring up your questions, please.
Yeah. Well, while you're doing that, we can summarize. What did we as hibernating doctors do? We actually had problems with going to the trunk, the celiac trunk. We also had an instable position in the celiac trunk, which we could have managed with maybe a long sheet that had a better catheter hooked into the trunk. Then with the microcatheter, did we have any problems there?
We had to change a little bit the shapes, but that I guess is
quite
normal.
Yeah.
So please let your questions come to Lars, and we are here to answer them. Yeah, so please use the go to webinar tool on the right hand side to type in your questions in the questions section, and Lars and I will try to answer your questions. So I'll give you a couple of minutes to do that.
While you wait, Dominic, we can emphasize that liver tumors are, as we have mentioned, usually perfused by vessels derived from the hepatic artery, more rarely from the SMA, but while normally the tissue is also perfused by the portal vein as well. So this gives the opportunity to selectively treat tumors by catheterization of the hepatic artery or part of the mesenteric artery going to the right lobe, and theoretically sparing normally the tissue. Also the HCC tumors mainly, and also the colorectal metastasis.
I have one question, Lars, regarding the different embolics. If you could explain a little bit what differences are there and when do you use them?
It's a very good and tricky question from the audience. Because there are many ways to skin the cat. As I said, if there would be a perfect embolization material, everyone would use it and we wouldn't have need for the other ones. I mean, what you have for different techniques are such as transarterial embolization is chemoembolization, immune embolization, and radioembolization as well. And so, I mean, it also depends on what you have decided on the multi disciplinary conference together, what is the best treatment for this typical patient. When it comes to HCC, we go for the Barcelona protocol, so that means that we have to there's no really good and simple answer to that. I mean, if you have radio embolization, you can use selective internal radiation therapy, which is called SIRT, CERT, and that's a method where radioactive isotopes from yttrium-90 or resin microspheres are deployed in the arterial circulation. They are pretty small. They are down to 60 microns. Or you can use yttrium-90. That's a beta radiation emitter with short range, less than 11 millimeter in liver tissue, which also gives you the opportunity to selectively treat tumors. So to make a short answer, there are lots of differences between embolization material when it comes to treating liver tumors.
The next question that I see here is, you almost, at least for one of the different methods, you already explained, which maybe just an approximate size of the beads that you use for embolization.
Yeah, always as a standard rule, you have to check how the flow is into the region you're going to embolize, and also see that you don't have any venous reflux over to the other side. So if you embolize with two small particles, you will have a AVF, arterial venous fistula, so you embolize into the lungs. But that's rarely the case in HCC. So you would go for 150 to 300 mainly. And you also have the discussion, should you be very near or should you go be a little bit away from the target? The thing is, what we didn't show here or the simulation is that you also can reduce cone beam CT. And what you will find when you embolize one or two feeders, that it will open up or even explode one or two new feeders that you have to treat. So you really have to go out and buy some patients when you do this kind of treatment.
It takes some time.
You're not always you are finished when you have done the two first feeders, because you will end up with one or two new ones that you will find. So take a long angle. When they did the DSA here, we made it very short, but you really have to stand on the pedal so you really can see how, if there's anyone.
Always check your result also at the end then.
Absolutely.
Very specific questions. The next one, I don't know if you have used those products yet. So how to prepare LifePearl and HepaSphere, so two specific beads brand names also. Do you have you used LifePearl or HepaSphere before, Lars?
No, that's out of my experience for the moment, I have to say. The one who asked the question presumably have more experience than I have, so maybe that person can text their opinion.
I think always ask the actual manufacturer for that specific preparation of the beads.
Absolutely, so you have to follow the instructions for use at all times. IFUs.
Mm-hmm. We have two more questions here. So do you continue with like bland embolization after you finish the drug eluting embolization when there is still on the end you're still some flow visible into the tumor? I hope I have answered.
Yeah, I would advise doing that. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Very good.
Yes. And very good. I think that is a good question also for you now. So the last one that we take now here, femoral or radial approach for this procedure, and also in combination with that, when would you recommend radial, and what would be the challenges for radial in this procedure? And is it even common to radial for this procedure?
Conservatively, you go from the groin for the femoral approach, but of course, if you have iliac occlusions, if you have an elderly patient and going for this treatment and you have occluded iliacs, then you have to go either from the brachial artery or for the radial artery. So that's truly an option, which is more and more common. As always, cardiologists already transfer to radial puncture. And many of the advances is that you have a mobile patient very quickly, I mean, who can take care of themselves after the treatment.
Mm-hmm.
For one thing, and the risk of actually we are working on at our department to go more for radial approaches as well. But then you also have to decide, should you go from the left side or from the right side? I mean, it's not always fun to go over the arch because you have the risk of small emboli going mm-hmm. to the cerebral region.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, you can go transradial if you're used to that and you have that in your hospital as a first primary choice.
Do you have time for one more question, Lars? Because I think there's one more good that I see here that
sure.
is interesting.
Yeah.
Sure. In particular, for colorectal cancer metastasis in the liver, which regime for serial tests or for several procedures do you recommend for this kind of?
That's a pretty good question as well, because that moves us to what is an interventional radiologist today. I would say that we are going more and more to have specialized in vascular interventional radiology, also moving to have oncology interventional specialist. And as an oncology interventional specialist, you also will get more involved in clinical care. So you have to be a really close part to the team, multidisciplinary teams into this, working closely with an oncologist. So that depends on the teamwork between an oncology interventional specialist. This is a field that is growing, so I would urge the younger doctors of today to really rethink that they shouldn't go into oncology interventions in close collaboration with oncologists.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think with that, the person says thank you for your answer also. So thank you, Lars, for this webinar. Thank you for everybody that joined us and asked really good questions.
And thank you all attendees, and thank you, Dominic. It was a pleasure as always.
Likewise. So if you are interested in this recording of this webinar, or if you want to show it to your colleagues, you can get in touch with us at info@mentice.com or bus@mentice.com. You should have that email address somewhere in your registration, and you can request that, and we will get in contact with you. And with that, I wish you a nice evening, morning, or afternoon, and see you with our next webinar soon. Bye-bye.